you're trying to be more proficient with your pistol, rifle, whatever, particularly your pistol, then you want to come up with a way to log your performance and how you're doing and how you're improving, or at least have some kind of standard to beat. And every now and then check it with a timer. I don't really like using timers all that much. I like to spend more time stressing myself out by just going as fast as I can to do things functionally, and then I test on top of that, because typically when you practice something over and over again, you learn how to cut the corners that are unnecessary, cut off the fat. So with all that said, I wanted to go ahead and share the test that I do and do it as quick as possible, but explain why I have these tests instead of using something like a 1-to-5, a Bill Wilson, you know, course of fire where you fire 6 rounds. I'm not going to call it a drill because it's not a drill. It's not something that you should be doing over and over and over again. You do it as a test. So with all that said, I don't like to stick with traditional tests. If I'm going to be checking the basics, I have my own reasons for this based on the firearm that I'm using. But basically, this is going to test all your basic skills that you need to have inherently, at least in my opinion. So let me go ahead and show you the board. So this is it. I basically have 6 things that I'm going to be testing, and obviously the last one's broken up into 3, and the first one's broken up into 2, as you can see here. So each one of these is done 3 times. So first thing is, obviously, I test my trigger speed. Now let me go ahead and lay out what that means. Basically, the trigger speed is, I perform this in double action and single action, where I basically load a snap cap into my pistol, and I basically test my ability to pull the trigger without moving the gun. Being that this is a double action, I have to test it on double action and on single action, because you can still have the pistol cocked. The hammer cocked back. If you're doing a long range shot, you might have the time to just swipe it back out of the holster and then take a precision shot with single action, or you just need to use double action, close quarters, you know, stuff like that, necessity. But basically, you have your finger off the trigger, and basically on the beep, you go beep, and you pull the trigger without moving the gun as much as you can to keep a small circle, try to keep it motionless. And on double action, beep, 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 you record your times, and I have to do them, you know, individually, and I'll share my little timer that I have, my phone that I use, at the end of the video. But with all that said, that's what I do. Trigger speed is an essential thing that you're going to be using all over the place, and it's never really going to change. You're going to need to be able to pull the trigger without moving the gun. So that's going to be an essential skill no matter what you're doing. So that's a good test. It's a basic test. It's basically a drill that you can actually do, and I'm testing myself on the speed of that drill. So anyways, with all that said, it should carry over into, you know, other courses of fire, and you can test that if you want, but this is a basic test. So the next one is going to be the draw speed. Now, I'm not really going to demonstrate that because we all know what the draw looks like, but basically, the times that I had for the first one, I just wanted to go ahead and put those in there, but my times for the double action was 0.28, and the single action was 0.23, and that's the average of 3. Now, the second one, the draw speed, 3.3 seconds. That's using a Bianchi leg holster that the military used, and that's basically the best for this M9A3. It's going to depend on the type of holster and the firearm that I'm using, but basically I'm drawing and having to deactivate that retention and drawing it and putting one shot accurately on target. It only counts if it's accurately on target. You can actually test this with some apps, with a laser trainer if you wish, but during this whole test, I am doing it 3 times, but I'm using a snap cap because I need to protect the firing pin. I want longevity in my pistol. So anyways, that's just my little recommendation. Now, the third one is an isometric hold, a weighted isometric hold of your pistol on an aim target. So as soon as you start moving around and you break the threshold of your small target, then the test is over and your time is concluded. And I typically conclude that time by having this thing in single action, and when I get out of that threshold, pull the trigger, and that tells my timer, okay, that's the end of it. And then I, you know, do my score, and I do this, you know, 3 times. So my average, it is what it is. I give a considerable amount of time in between. However, what do I use to weigh it down? I use my Steyr AUG, and I basically, what I'll do is I will safe it, I will lock the bolt back, and I will take out the magazine. The magazine is not an essential part. I just want the bare weight of it. The reason I lock back the bolt on my Steyr It's basically to center the balance into the rear, because the Styria-UG's balance when the bolt is forward is more centered and it's right on the grip. When it's locked back, it's more like the Tavor, where the weight is mostly at the back. So I want that weight, I personally want that weight centered at the back, so I get the weight as far down as possible, and that way I don't have a big bulky thing side to side. I just have it as much straight up and down as I can get. So I basically have it on a sling, and I basically hold it right here, right in front of the front sight. That way I'm getting as much weight at the end of the muzzle as possible. I want to use the front sight as a stopper, so it doesn't slip off, and then I drop my rifle. But it's not really that big of a deal. It's not really that far off the ground, but your weight, it's whatever you want to use. But this one I can hold for 62 seconds. So basically, on the beep, I go, and obviously I already have it in single action, I'm ready to go, and I try to have it braced, and then beep, and I hold it on the target as still as possible, and my target is typically only about an inch or two wide. So you gotta have that standardized and figure it out. And then, of course, you test it and see where you're at. This is going to show you how well you can hold up your pistol. You know, of course you're not going to hang your rifle when you're holding someone up or pointing a loaded gun at them. However, I think it is actually essential to have an understanding of how well you're going to be able to hold the weight of your pistol when you're actually having to use it and be ready to use it. Holding it on target, it basically shows your strength, your upper body strength, and that's something that I think is essential to good shooting, and also your grip, because you want to be able to hold your grip nice and tight when you're doing this. So it tests a couple things. So with all that said, let's go ahead and move on to the next thing. The next one is quite simple. You're going to need a loaded magazine with one snap cap in it, so I can just eject this snap cap and move it over here. Obviously, it's just the reload. So what I do is I typically will aim in and I'll do a check. I'll get my mushy trigger, and on the beep, I'll get a mushy trigger and then I'll do a check. That's a natural thing that I do, and I'll keep it around because it's always good to check. It could be a malfunction. So then, of course, this is a speed reload. Depending on where you store your magazine, you want to do it honestly. You don't want to just do it on an open rig. Do it with some retention. Whatever the one is that's most retained, that's my recommendation, to keep yourself honest and challenge yourself. It's always good to challenge yourself and test yourself from the hardest position possible. So, basically mushy trigger, check, and then get around on target accurately. That's my test. And my time for that is actually 3.8 seconds because of the storage of my magazine. It's actually in a pocket that doesn't have a flap on it, but it is retained. It's kind of low profile and it's kind of closed off a little bit, and I may have to fish for it. Also, another thing that can affect your time is if you prefer to go to a kneeling. If you're testing this around cover, you have some kind of standardized response that you want to actually have and make instinctive, then you should actually incorporate this, because these are things that you can actually drill. These are things that are good to drill, and it shouldn't change regardless of the position or if it's night or day. And obviously you shouldn't be having to look at the gun or where you're drawing the magazine from. This should be practiced to the point it's instinctive, to where it's so boring that you don't even have to look at the gun. It's just like, yep, you're just reloaded, you're good to go. So anyways, that's my little spiel on the reload portion, and that's why I do it. It shouldn't change, and I do it consistently. So next thing is basically the SAS agility test. And this is something that you can drill, I guess, but I would do a little bit more of a variety. Go ahead and look at my video on the SAS agility test. It's a little bit further back. It was a couple weeks ago that I posted it from the date of this video. So just check out my playlist on techniques and stuff like that. But with all that said, I like to do the SAS agility test because basically you go from standing, kneeling, prone, supine, back to prone, then kneeling, then standing. And you're doing two rounds on each. This was designed around the Browning High Power, so they had 14 rounds to test this with. You have the same, but I would actually have 15 rounds, so you're not getting an empty magazine at the end. If you wish to actually have an empty magazine at the end and then do a reload and then just, or 14 rounds and then do a reload and shoot your 15th round into the target to kind of test how you're doing, if you're too winded or not, because it can be stressful, that's on you. But gauge your times accordingly and with a good standard that is, easy to match. So, with all that said, my time on this, after three tries, was actually 14.1 seconds, which is actually good because that's 14 rounds in 14 seconds. That's actually the standard in order to pass the SAS test. However, I'm using a double action, and plus I was in, I was basically using, you know, my pistol for what it was, and I was going at a pace where I could actually shoot accurately instead of just trying to go for speed. Necessarily. So I could have cut that time down a little bit more. I was actually kind of proud of myself. So with all that said, the last thing that I actually do practice is malfunction. Each one of them is tested, 1, 2, and 3. And I'm going to break those down pretty simply. So number one, obviously, you know, goes click. Okay, so that could be obviously one of two things. It doesn't matter. You can learn that if you do some basic firearms training, what can cause that and everything else. But what I found is, unless it's the first round that you try to get back on, like you do a reload and then, you know, you get an empty chamber, I actually have that more than once because failure to seat the magazine, especially when you're stressed, I see that most of the time. Most of the time, you will need to tap your pistol in, but if it's done in the middle of a firing, whatever the reasons are, I just rack the thing. So, anyways, it happens sometimes, and it could just be a primer that's not really that good. With a double action, you can train yourself to restrike if you wish before you actually go into corrective action. Obviously, a snap cap's going to be needed for this. Two of them, basically. So when you rack this, you basically have another round that you can test, or just leave it on an empty chamber and then just rack in the good round. But anyways, with all that said, that's the first one. And my time on that is actually 2.5. Now, the reason for that is what I do is I basically do my single action shot like it's basically in the middle of firing, and then I do a check, and then I immediately correct it. Now you can do both if you wish to actually prepare for both, like a failure to fully seat the magazine. That's something that you can practice if you wish, and I would keep a log of that. So just keep that open, but I'm kind of closed-minded in the idea of that, because typically if I feel that I'm a little short, I'll just tap and go in. It's not really that big of a deal. But anyways, the second one is obviously like the stovepipe, the failure to eject. It's ejection that it has failed. So basically what you've got is you might have an inline stovepipe where basically the round hasn't ejected and it's in line and faced forward or backwards. It's just stuck right there. Or you can have the little stovepipe where it's faced up or down or, you know, whatever, it's sticking out. So basically for this is, if I actually have that, that means that the round tried to eject. I don't need to tap it because the magazine's seated. It's not a big deal. And then basically what I do is I just relieve the slide enough. I barely move it back and I put my finger on the slide like this. So again, I check it, I evaluate it, and then boom, or I try to fire it, I evaluate and check it, and then I go through my course. And I have to slow down at this point. And that's why my time is 2.9 seconds, 2.9 seconds after three tries of this. So I have to slow down in order to eject it and then put a round on target. So that's my test, done three times, that's why. The last one is going to be a type 3. So with that, the way I practice it, and I will get to this in another video on whatever, I practice a failure to extract, not a double feed, a failure to extract. I do practice double feed sometimes, but typically a double feed is going to be treated the same as this. So basically, the way I do it, it's my average is 5.9 seconds out of three times, and it's just going fast enough to actually do everything correctly without looking at it. And so basically, I click, what the hell, check, and then it's like, okay, so I lock back the magazine, and I lock back the slide to, and then pull out the magazine, and then I hold it, and I rack it twice, if it needs to be racked twice. But typically, if you're just using snap caps, it's going to come out anyways. If you use a piece of used brass, typically it'll stick in there, so you actually have to, you know, send it home and rack it twice. You have options on what you drill into your head. You don't have to do, you know, two racks. You can just send it home with the slide release to hook the extractor, hopefully hook it on the piece of brass enough to eject it. And then you insert your new ammunition, and it, when you power stroke it, it'll eject that brass that didn't want to come out the first time, and then it'll feed it a live round from your magazine. Hopefully. But it's up to you if you want to use that cheat, if it's really that kind of circumstance. Sometimes it's not, and you actually have a completely screwed extractor, where it's actually chipped and it just ain't going to work. No go, no mojo, no happiness. So anyways, that's all the tests that I like to do. I could go on for a long time, and I will. I have to make a video about malfunctions and the misconceptions out there. But anyways, with all that said, that is my skill test. These are basic. This isn't really any 1 to 5 or anything like that. This is specifically testing these individual skills that are going to be universal and necessary. These are foundational skills. They're foundational. They are not essential skill. They're not basic skill. They are foundational. You need each one of these in order to be a well-rounded shooter of a pistol. And you need to test it with each type of pistol. And if you want, see what your average is on all these and on these times or whatever. But that's just what I've come up with through my research, my experience, and what I feel is actually necessary for what I'm using these specific pistols for. Obviously, the holster, it shows what I actually intend to use this for. It's not going to be for concealed carry. So I'm not going to use a Safari Land. I'm not paying $150 for a new holster. I'm just not. I'd rather spend that on ammunition, but that's just me. So anyways, use what you want with it, but this is my test, and hopefully this is kind of encouragement to do your own research, find out your skills, what you need to work on and such. And I've broken it down into individual components, but I do have more advanced tests that I can do to kind of see how I synergize these different skills together and test the recoil. But this can be done dry or on the range. Typically we want to do them on the range to get a good evaluation of how we respond when we actually add the recoil. So with all that said, I appreciate you guys watching. Go ahead and leave a comment below. Let me know what you think, and you guys have a good one.